Thank you so much, Michael.
I told Michael I would not say it, but I'm going to say it. For me, the clearest experience of no self is hearing somebody introduce me. That was not me at all. But it must be out there somewhere, right? The other experience of no self, which maybe some of you have, but maybe not, is football, right? Have you ever thought about how we identify with the football team to the point that we say we when we're actually not playing, right? And it's actually not one person, but a bunch of persons, right? The Buddhists never use the football analogy, but they use the army analogy, which is very similar. Right? It is like the self, a total illusion, a compounded thing that we imagine that is only one thing that is real. Okay, the topic today is extremely difficult. Beginning with the very word psychotherapy and meditation, which of course means so many different things. As they should. There's nothing wrong with words meaning many things. If words did not mean many things, there would be nothing. Okay, this is basic principle of linguistics. What makes words mean is the fact that they mean many things. They sort of shift back and forth. However, in something like meditation and psychotherapy, you could substitute that with something like love and liberty, because it's the same level. Now, those words that are injected with so much emotion, you know, for us it's so important. So my opinion of what real love is very important. My emotion that I wrap around that word. Liberty, democracy, all of those words, justice, right? And it's like their meditation in the same family. Okay? Just think about what most people think when they think of a psychotherapist or a meditator. Some people may think maybe smart enough to be very skeptical of the words, but most people are not skeptical. They are somehow credulous, like, oh, psychotherapy, it's supposed to be a nice person. Believe me, all kinds of psychotherapists, okay? Oh, he meditates, or she meditates. Oh, must be a serene person. Anybody who has meditated and is honest knows that that's not true. I have a friend who said he practices meditation the same way that an alcoholic goes to the Alcoholic Anonymous meetings, right? He goes because he knows he needs it, okay, desperately. Very well. I shall focus my comments on the general question of what these two fields of human endeavor, meditation, psychotherapy, but they share, of course, very briefly, we don't have much time. And what distinguishes them, and also what would be needed for the two fields to somehow speak to each other, which I think is what should happen. Needless to say, they speak to each other, but often in ways that are sort of at cross purposes. So I'm saying what would be needed for people to actually listen to the other field endeavor and see what could be of use for me, if I were a meditator, or me, if I was a therapist. To begin with, the relationship between psychology and meditation, or if I may, if you allow me, and religion, I know that some people practice meditation and believe it's not religion, but it is religion, it's a special kind, but it's religion nonetheless. But the relationship between psychology and religion is very old. In fact, depending on how you define the terms, go back thousands of years. If you think of it in terms of modern psychological science, it goes back to about the 15th century, the 16th century actually, when Johan Leyen, a Dutch physician, for the first time said that witches are not possessed by the devil. They are mentally ill. And of course, he got into trouble with the church. But it was the first time that someone says, if I as a physician observe one of these people, I cannot see any kind of demon, I can see a mental illness, and they should be treated as mentally ill people. Today we know it's more complicated than that. Not always were they ill, sometimes they were just people who were different, and they suffered the consequences. But if we take that as a point of departure, we have then at least 500 years of exchanges between psychology and religion, and they are mixed, right? Sometimes psychology is not happy with religion, sometimes it is. If you take Carl Jung, Carl Jung somehow mixes religion and psychology in interesting ways. In my humble opinion, he distorts both, but that's my personal opinion. Needless to say, I work into both psychotherapy and meditation. The critical eye of the philologist and the historian, and you'll notice it, and that might not be make everybody happy, but I bring that to him. So when I look at someone like Carl Jung, to use him as an example, I say, well, where is what he's saying about religion? Where is it in the history of religion? And I don't find it, right? And that's part of the problem. But let's leave him aside, that's for another lecture. The actual idea that there might be something in Buddhism that is psychological has been around for a long time. And a lot of people think, well, Buddhism is not a religion. Used to be in the old days, and they'd say it's a philosophy. And then people started saying, no, it's a psychology. The truth of the matter is that Buddhism is Buddhism. And it may have a little bit of psychology, a little bit of philosophy, but it is Buddhism, and we need to understand it as Buddhism, not as something else. But the idea that there might be something in Buddhism that we may call psychological did not take any kind of, shall we say, well thought through formulation until about 1985, when a Sri Lankan psychiatrist at the Maudsley is perhaps the most prestigious psychiatric hospital in England, he wrote a number of papers in which he reflected on the possible connection, not connection, or possible similarity between systems of Buddhist meditation and mental discipline and behavioral therapy. He's a behaviorist, by the way, and that's the way he went. Okay. Eventually, however, much later, already into the 70s, two things happened that I think are very important in psychology from the point of view of what we want to talk about today. One was a psychologist by the name of Marsha Linehan, an American, who practiced primarily with Zen teachers, but also occasionally with some Tibetan teachers, and was very much interested in borderline personality disorder, which is a very difficult disorder to treat. By the way, as a footnote, I don't like the word disorder, but that's the one they use. It was used in the Middle Ages, by the way, to talk about disorder and passions. It makes me very nervous, but that's the word the psychologists use, disorder. But anyway, she recently, by the way, revealed that she has suffered from borderline personality disorder herself, a severe borderline personality. But the thing is, she developed a therapy which already in the 90s had become very, very influential and popular, because it had one of the requirements, ideal requirements in therapy, which is what we call empirical base. In other words, you will all do things with the patients and they feel happy and say, oh yeah, I'm success. But that's not science. It's important. It's kind of the human relationship of the therapist to the patient. Science is when you can actually demonstrate that what you did resulted in an improvement in the patient. And that's called empirically based therapy. And she was able to develop a therapy that could be empirically based, could be tested, and it was very successful. It is now the preferred therapy for borderline personality disorder. It's called dialectical therapy or dialectical behavioral cognitive therapy or whatever, most ominous terms. And she based most of it on Buddhist notions of mindfulness, in a peculiar sense of the word mindfulness. And that's where the trouble starts. But that peculiar set of sense is very much psychotherapeutic, very much North American, and I suspect today also in Western European, and has notions that really don't find in the old Buddhist texts. So that's where the problem starts, okay? Notions such as forgiving yourself. If anyone here can find Buddhist texts that talks about forgiving yourself, I will allow you to please call me at home anytime of the night, 3 a.m., 4 a.m., because I want to hear about it. Okay? Now, be careful. I'd like to joke about it, to be playful. That doesn't mean I think it's a bad idea. I think it's a good idea to forgive yourself. I'm just saying it is not in Buddhist text. That's all I'm saying. Okay? Like there are so many other things that are good that are not in the Buddhist text, right? Microwaves are not in the Buddhist text. And it's good to have microwave, right? So it's two different things, whether it's in there, whether it's good, two completely different things, completely different judgments. So anyway, that was the first effective empirically based psychotherapy that had some kind of Buddhist influence. Okay? And it is, by the way, extremely sophisticated, and if you ask me, after some complete subjective judgment, what percent of that therapy is Buddhist, I would say about 20%. The rest is traditional cognitive behavioral techniques, but of course used in very, very ingenious ways, which she was able to do in part because she had suffered from the disorder, so she knew how to get out of it. Okay? Following that, very soon thereafter, a number of psychologists, North American and British primarily, but now it's in Germany and places, developed a technique called mindfulness therapy, which was especially effective for pain and depression. It's been extended to other disorders, but so far, the most solid empirical evidence is with respect to chronic pain and depression, which some of you may know are closely related. If you get depressed, you suffer more pain. So from our pain, you get depressed. It's a circle, and it's very important to break the circle at some point. We could reflect philosophically on dukkha, right? But we won't go there. You can do a lot of interesting reflections. Well, but the most important thing, because I tried to sort of summarize the gist before I give you more details in case we run out of time. The most important point is that these techniques or these therapies are seen by those who use them as primarily empirically based therapies. So that the empirical test is the primary issue here. So if I tell you, look, I have a Buddhist meditation for you that will cure you, and I say, think about Coca-Cola all day long, if it cures you, it is an effective meditation from a psychological point of view. But it's not Buddhist, of course. And I'm exaggerating just to make a point clear, right? I'm exaggerating. So not everything that these psychologists do you can actually find in the tradition. But there are some similarities, and I hope I can show some of them. Okay? They are subtle, very important. What I suspect in the case of these psychologists, what it reflects is essentially North American Buddhism. Right? It's not something you'll find in the politics, but it is something you'll find in North America in many places. Okay? And in that sense, as a historian of religion, I have to be honest, it is Buddhism. I'm just saying it is not in the text, but it is Buddhism. It's a new kind of Buddhism. Okay, so this process that you bring to the alleviation of suffering has to be somehow, ideally at least, first based on some kind of empirical proof that it actually works. And second, this is very important because this does not always apply to Buddhism, although you find it in some living traditions. It has to be client-oriented. Client-oriented means that your intervention, or that's the technical term, intervention, what you do, has to be tailored to the needs of the patient, and therefore has to respond to whatever is ailing the patient, specifically that person. In a sense, like medicine, no matter how much you know about the statistics about a particular medication, you have to consider the patient, him or herself. But not only do you tailor it to this person, but you often in psychotherapy, you make concessions to the person. So you shift or change the technique according to the person.